For our Experts in Emotion interview, we'll be speaking with Dr. George Bonanno on emotion and resilience. Dr. Bonanno is a professor of clinical psychology and director of the Loss, Trauma, and Emotion Lab in the Department of Counseling and Clinical Psychology at Teachers College, Columbia University. He received his PhD from Yale University in 1991 and has been a visiting professor at the University of Hong Kong and in Italy. Professor Bonanno's interests center on the question of how human beings cope with loss, trauma, and other forms of extreme adversity, with an emphasis on resilience as well as the salutary role of emotion regulatory processes. His recent empirical and theoretical work has focused on defining and documenting resilience in the face of loss or potentially traumatic events. This includes disaster, the death of loved ones, terrorist attacks, bioepidemics, traumatic injury, and life-threatening injuries and medical events. He also focuses on identifying the range of psychological and contextual variables that predict both psychopathological as well as resilient outcomes, as well as other patterns of outcomes, including gradual recovery and delayed reactions. Dr. Bonanno's work has been funded by the National Institutes of Health, the National Science Foundation, and the Rockefeller Foundation, and featured in various print, television, and radio media, including the New York Times, Science News, Scientific American, Wall Street Journal, The Washington Post, Time, Newsweek, CNN, 2020, and NPR. He's also co-edited the book, Emotion, Current Issues and Future Directions, and recently authored The Other Side of Sadness, What the New Science of Bereavement Can Tell Us About Life After Loss. So I now turn to our Experts in Emotion interview with Dr. George Bonanno. So welcome, George. Thanks for speaking with us today.
Hi, June. Nice to speak with you.
What I'd love to ask you a bit about is sort of where things first began for you. So what first got you interested in trying to understand emotion and resilience more generally?
That's actually kind of an interesting story. I had learned about emotion as a graduate student in part of my graduate research. And then I was looking for a slightly different direction because I'm trained as a clinician. So I took a position as a kind of a career change. I took a position in San Francisco with Marty Horowitz, who was a very influential trauma researcher. I took a position working with him running a bereavement project. And I was a little bit unsure about that. But what got me interested and what ultimately compelled me to take this position was that there was this fairly voluminous literature on bereavement and loss, and it seemed woefully out of date, especially when it came to emotion. So there are lots of ideas about emotion, about working through and something called grief work that seemed incredibly simplistic and out of date. So Marty had suggested that I had real freedom to set up that project, and there were a lot of resources there, and he was an interesting man. So we set up a range of studies where we could code facial expressions and, in a sense, inculcate paradigms to really understand what people were doing when they were supposedly doing grief work and processing. And that was fascinating because everything we found was completely contrary to this existing literature that compelled me really to what I'm doing now.
That's so interesting. So finding this gap and being able to apply, you know, the tools of emotion to really get in and understand how we cope with trauma and how we can be resilient.
Yes, and we began to find, as I mentioned, counterintuitive things, and it was quite primitive initially, but we've since, you know, continued along that line, and the story has gotten more and more interesting over time.
Yeah, so I'd love to ask you about this story and how it's developed and your work in this area. So, I mean, your work has really paved the way for understanding this idea of resilience, or that, you know, people have this amazing ability to rebound from incredibly difficult life events and traumas. And so I think for many of us, that is kind of a surprising and counterintuitive finding, like you're saying. And I wonder if you could just first tell us a little bit more about how you understand the nature of what resiliency is.
Well, what's interesting about it is that we began to identify resilience by simply mapping people's progression over time. So we began to see that large numbers of people seem to take the hit or to take the impact of an aversive event. Initially, it was loss, then we moved on to other kinds of traumatic events. They seem to be able to take that impact and really find an equilibrium relatively soon afterwards. And so then there were usually a lot of people, often half or more of the samples we looked at. I'd say anywhere between one third and two thirds, but it's often more than half. So we initially just charted those trajectories across time and saw that people were coping really well. And there was a slight disequilibration initially, but otherwise they were coping well. And then as that became more and more of an empirical reality, we saw this so many times in different studies, we then began to try to understand what those processes were. And it led to a very interesting paradigm shift from the discipline really focused on pathology. And they would kind of divided people into two groups, those who had pathology and those who more or less recovered. And the recovery idea was not well understood. It was assumed that people kind of must have struggled mightily and over a great period of time recovered because pathology was so nasty looking, right? PTSD reactions and whatnot. But what we found by looking at the trajectories, actually the resilient people don't struggle for too long. It's not pleasant, but they don't struggle for too long. And it's resulted in a shift to focusing on what it is that they're doing. And it's led to this idea really that there's a, we're really wired, I think, quite elegantly to cope with adversity. We have a lot of mechanisms in place. And we understand at a neural level, a little bit neuroanatomical level, psychological level.
I mean, it's just a really neat idea that we're sort of wired to be resilient in many ways. And but it sounds at the same time like this was and is a really different idea from what people traditionally thought. And so how do you think that your work on resilience fits with previous conceptions of, you know, how people thought we recover from things like, you know, trauma or loss?
I think probably the biggest change from traditional conceptions is that it happens relatively quickly. And that the mechanisms we have, emotions being one of those mechanisms, a stress response system, it works relatively quickly. It's designed to do its job within a couple days or even less. So, you know, the neuroendocrine system looks like it functions for over a 2 to 4 hour period of time, you know, and that we have an intense stress reaction, cortisol's, you know, going into our system and doing what it does, ramping things up and suppressing immune functioning and whatnot. And that happens really over a relatively short period of time. And, you know, with highly aversive events, natural disasters or losses and other types of events that they just don't go away, they sometimes have enduring stress or enduring challenges for days. So the process may last a bit longer in that case. But I think that's really the ultimate shift, is that it works pretty quickly. And when things don't go well, we now are beginning to understand how, for some reason, those processes don't, for lack of a better term, they don't shut themselves off. You know, so they continue, and then things start getting, then we start leading into dysfunction and pathology.
It's so fascinating that we have this readily mobile and rapid response system in a way to cope with these really difficult life events. So it's a really important insight that your work has shown. I mean, you've also done so many other things. I mean, one of the things that I know has gained a lot of attention is, you know, your work really providing scientific evidence suggesting that some of our most common practices for how we cope, you know, with grief and trauma counseling, especially immediately after a traumatic event occurs, may actually be counterintuitive, right? Or actually be harmful for us. And so I wondered if you could tell us a little bit about your work here.
Yeah. I don't do the intervention work, yes. But... my contribution, if there is one here, is simply to attend to what's happening and write about it. But there was a kind of a burgeoning idea, probably in the late 80s, early 1990s, that everybody could be given kind of a very brief clinical intervention, and that in a sense, whole populations could be given these prophylactic interventions relatively early on. And it seemed like such a good idea. And the irony of all this is that people who were administered these interventions, they've gone under the name of critical incident debriefing or grief work or grief counseling. People felt that they helped. They reported that it helped them. The therapist giving those interventions reported that it helped people. They said they thought it helped people. The actual data suggested otherwise. The data showed that brief interventions didn't do anything, or they made people worse. And initially that was dismissed as, you know, anomalous data. But over time it became very clear, and meta-analyses were done And it's very clear now that it's simply that brief interventions simply don't work. And it's probably because they undermine the natural processes we have. You know, we're in a highly kind of an emergency state, if you will, and our things are going on inside us, for lack of a better way to put it, that are relatively automatic and ancient, really. And to receive some sort of a clinical intervention just simply changes that process. It gives people a different set, frame to think about the appearance of a mental health professional who's saying the word trauma is very frightening to people. So we don't know exactly why that is. And one reason why we don't know exactly why that is because it's not really possible to research it anymore, because the evidence is so clear that brief interventions are ineffective or harmful that really it's unethical to do the random trials anymore with those kinds of studies.
So what do you think might be best advice for individuals who have just recently suffered a traumatic life event?
Advice is always a tricky thing. But basically, I think that's a big question right now. It looks like, and we've when we've had to, my colleagues and I, when we've spelled out what we think the state of affairs are for brief interventions, we've suggested really that interventions aren't really appropriate for about a month, because people, there's a lot of variability. There's a great deal of variability in how people react initially. And that variability doesn't predict anything. So, you know, a strong initial reaction tends not to predict later trauma reactions. So really we need to let those reactions run their course. And I think I don't know about advice, but at least the information that people could be given is that they'll probably be, most people are okay, and those reactions are natural reactions to highly unusual situations, and they're adaptive reactions. And if they usually abate after, you know, as I said, a few days or so, sometimes longer. After a period of time, if they're not getting better, then we can start talking about intervention. And the field is grappling with this question now: what role do mental health professionals have in that first month? And there are lots of proposals. There's something called psychological first aid, which is about kind of education and being available. And there are pros and cons to those approaches. They're not empirically tested. One of the things that's emerged in studies of disaster is what people really want when they're asked what they want from outside sources. They want help with their immediate needs. They want help finding loved ones. They want help with infrastructure, housing, food, etc. They don't list mental health professional intervention as an immediate need. So that's something where, as I said, the field is now really trying to understand what role do mental health professionals have in that early time.
Ryan, it sounds like a tricky issue, but that, you know, what might be important, at least if there is some role, is some degree of just normalization and acceptance of a response that any person would have to an extremely traumatic life event.
Yes, and some of the work that I've been doing as a kind of a offshoot of this is on something we're calling regulatory flexibility or psychological flexibility, and there's a lot of interest in that, and that's got a nice message to it, because the message of flexibility is that different events require different kinds of coping or different kinds of responses. And so whatever works for a person and is probably good. And I think most people know what actually works for them. They're a little reluctant because they're waiting for the mental health world to tell them what to do. But I think that most people actually know what they need to do, you know, what they intuitively would help them at a certain point in time. And I think that the message, the public health message of the flexibility research is probably you know best what you need to do for yourself.
And to let the mental health profession be flexible in tuning what they do to meet the needs that you perhaps already know what they might be.
A good point, yeah. Yes.
So one of the other things I want to ask you about, and it's one of the things that I first read in your work, and I just loved the message in this work as well, is that you found that, you know, during times of coping with traumatic loss, such as the love or the loss of a loved one, that genuine smiling, even laughter, may be actually a really healthy response to these kinds of stressors, as opposed to what people would typically think of as crying during these events. And so I know this might sound surprising to many people that, you know, laughter and smiling may actually be a really good response, you know, when you've lost a loved one or when something traumatic has happened. So I wonder if you could just flesh this out for people who may be hearing this for the first time.
Yeah. What's interesting about the laughter work, we initially did this work. I did this with Dacher Keltner, the University of California, Berkeley, who you know very well. And we coded laughter from the face, so from the eye, the muscles around the eyes, the so-called Duchenne expression, so we didn't have to ask people, which was handy because for some events like loss, there is still, I think, an assumption that laughter is, smiling is inappropriate. Yet when we filmed people early on after a loss, we found that the majority tended to show these genuine laughs and smiles. They're interpersonal, so they're laughing and smiling when they're talking with an interviewer about their loss. And we saw them right in the midst of crying and, you know, not everybody cries, but in the midst of great pain, and people recounting very difficult times. And the ubiquity of these expressions made it clear that they're really part and parcel with what people do. And I think the field had really written very little about this, particularly in the bereavement literature, very little mention of laughter and smiling. And if they were mentioned, they were mentioned as a kind of a denial. You know, people are not telling jokes, although in some cultures they do tell jokes as well. But it really was about fond memories and positive interpersonal exchanges. And it led to really a kind of a formulation that, you know, emotional reactions are not ongoing. For example, if you become sad, you're not in a state of sadness for 3 weeks. It's an ephemeral process that comes and goes. And while it's coming and going, so you may have a brief, intense period of sadness that dissipates. And when it dissipates, there's a kind of a reconnection with the people around one. And that's at a time when people laugh and smile as a way of indicating, I think, positive affiliation and indicating the connection with others. So we had talked about early on two functions of laughter and smiling. One was that it was a kind of a coping breather. And this is something that goes way back to Susan Falkman's work and Dick Lazarus' work. Laughter and smiling are kind of give us breaks, and they allow us to recharge. They help us regulate ourselves. And of course, Barbara Fredrickson has done wonderful things with this idea, the broaden and build model of positive emotion. But the other is their profound interpersonal function. So laughter and smiling connect us to other people. So, you know, in bereavement, you see people who are in intense sadness, intense pain, looking inward. They're reflecting on what they've lost and what they need to do to recalibrate. And then they come out of that state for a few moments and they smile and laugh with the people around them, and it reconnects them. And this is wonderfully adaptive. It's almost perfect in a way. You know, we have this process where we do this internal struggle, and then we reconnect with the people around us who can take care of us and who we need. And we see that very profoundly with loss. There's been less research on the same thing with trauma, but we do see that positive emotions early on in trauma also predict a better outcome.
So I like the message that you're saying, in a way that it gives us a break and allows us to sort of look out and reach out to connect to other people.
Absolutely, yeah. And it's very much human.
That's nice. I mean, what would a human life be without laughter, in a way, right? So I just wanted to ask you, you know, you've done all this really interesting research on resiliency, coping with trauma and loss, and the important role that laughter can play, and flexibility as well. When you think about all the work you've done and sort of what took you there, now if you sort of project into the future, I know it's a big thing to think about, but when you do, where do you see the future of emotion headed? Sort of what do you think is in store next?
I think it's a great question. I think where emotion is going, I think your own work is pointed to this direction as well, June, that we're beginning now to become aware of the important role of context and how different emotion regulation processes, different emotional experiences, how they vary across situations, and how we really have to take that into consideration to have a full model of emotion. and that what we think is adaptive is only adaptive in some situations. And I think your work on positive emotion suggests this as well, that there are times when it's not adaptive and there's a dark side. And I love to look at the biological world in this regard. There is nothing in the biological world in terms of animal adaptations, there isn't one that's completely all good or all bad. They all have costs and benefits. They're trade-offs. So emotion regulation is the same way. It's generally an adaptive thing, which is why we study it and why we think it's functional. But it's only adaptive when it sort of matches the context in the right way. And I think that idea is only beginning to catch on. And it suggests a more complicated scenario, one that we have to understand. But I think that's where the field is going to go, or what we need to understand.
No, I think you're absolutely right, because our emotions, it's easier to study them if they occurred in a vacuum, but that's just not the reality of life, right? They're unfolding in these dynamic, changing contexts, and one emotion that may be good in one moment could rapidly shift to being maladaptive in another moment in another context, just like what you're saying so elegantly. Yeah. So then my final question for you is, when we're thinking about the future, a big part of the future in emotion research involves the next generation of students and scholars. And if they came up to you and said, you know, what advice do you have for me, George? You know, how should I be thinking about the future of research in emotion? What advice might you give them?
Well, I would say think critically. Think about how we measure things and what that tells us. I think the way we measure something definitely informs what we see, what we know. And it's very easy especially in an academic context, it's very easy to get stuck in a certain small set of ways to measure things. We use questionnaires a lot. We all know the limits of questionnaires. But even our experimental paradigms, they're all fairly similar. And the same paradigms produce the same results. And when we really think about what we're doing with our measurements and how we approach a topic, we sometimes come up with novel ways to look at things, and we find something new. And I think this is a very young field. It's nascent, really. It's not more than a several decades old, the study of emotion and emotion regulation. There's a lot of interest in the face right now, what the face really tells us. There's a lot of interest in these various emotion regulatory processes, whether suppressing is a bad or not, whether reappraisal is a necessary process. And those are only a few of the many ways we regulate ourselves. And so there's so much to know, and it really requires that the next generation thinks about what it is that we do when we have emotions and we regulate them, and how can we study that? And there's so much more we can do.
Thank you so much for speaking with us today. This concludes our Experts in Emotion interview with Dr. George Bonanno from Columbia University.